There's a message on my heart today. I want you to turn in your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And I'm not in any series right now. Instead, I'm picking some topics that I think are important as we follow up after Easter. And so as we do that, I want to deal with a topic today that I think, last week we looked at the assurance of salvation. How many of you absolutely know for sure you're going to heaven now? All right. If you didn't know that last week, you should have known that by the time you left. All right. And so I wanted to make sure that as we follow up after Easter, and I know people are new in the Lord, and some of you maybe still have some of these issues you've never really settled in your life. And so assurance of salvation was very important. There's another topic that I think is important, also goes along with that, and that is the freedom that we have in Christ. And I want to talk about that today. It's normally a message I say for like the 4th of July, but it's one that I really felt like it's the timing is now, and we need to understand what the Lord is telling us in this area. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, picking up with verse 12, let me read this. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and stomach for the food, but God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Then shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh. But he who unites himself with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from sexual immorality, and all other sins a man commits are outside of his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. Father, thank you so much that, Lord, you gave the ultimate so that we might be saved. And Lord God, you have called us to a life that is different than anything we had before. Help us understand that and live in that in the way that you've called us to in this world. In Jesus' name I pray for your anointing upon the word and upon your messenger, that, Lord God, that my words would be your words, and that, Lord God, we would all hear what the Spirit has to say today. In Christ's name, amen. Now, we know that freedom is a big issue with Americans. As a matter of fact, as we are going through this year's presidential election, the issues of freedom are important topics that are addressed from various different angles depending on the candidate and depending on their particular political persuasion. We sing, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty." All right? At every baseball game, "Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free, the home of the brave." And in the news of late, our issues of abortion and gay rights and transgender bathrooms and the flag being burned, where freedom is being put to a test. And it is used as a scapegoat for allowing offensive behavior. Freedom is also a big issue with Christians. Jesus came to set us free. In John 8, he says, "Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." And so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Galatians 5, "It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." And so we see in 2 Corinthians 3:17, "Now The Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And so we see freedom and liberty are big topics in the Word of God, especially as we look in the New Testament and see what has taken place because of Christ. And so as a result of that, we need to understand, what does that mean? What effect does all of this have on my life? You see, freedom is something that sets us free from the law as well as from the law of sin and death. To bind someone up and to set to a set of rules is the opposite of what Christ came to do. Many people look at Christianity as a set of rules, and so they say, you must do this, 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 and this, and not do this, this, and this, and then you are a Christian, okay? That's a misunderstanding of what Christianity is about, all right? But some people have tossed it the whole other direction, and they let the pendulum all the way to the other side, where they just say, I am free, I have no rules, I am just, you know, it's Woodstock all over again. So what effect should all of this have on the way we live? Francis Schaeffer once said, how then shall we live? And so as a Christian, I think that's kind of a really kind of where I want to go with this message today, is how do we live? What is the basis for the choices of how you and I are supposed to live as Christians that is God-honoring, but yet is living in our freedom and not under the yoke of religious slavery? Should we go out and burn the spiritual flags of Christianity in order to express our freedom in Christ? I think the Bible tells us, God forbid. The Apostle Paul lays down some very important principles for how a Christian should live. And the basic theme, I believe, running through this is the title I gave this message today, and that is, who do I belong to? If you can answer that question, then you can answer many of the other questions about how then shall we live. And so, looking at our text, I want to look at a few key verses, all right? First of all, we are purchased by God. All right? You are not your own, it says in verse 19. You know, the shout of pro-choice women is that it's my body. Nobody has a right to tell me what to do with my own body. Well, I don't want to get into the issue so much of abortion, but move to the next screen there. You'll see that there's also another person that wants to know about their choice, about their life as well. But the idea being is that we don't have control of our body if we are a Christian. Because he says, you are not your own, you are purchased by God. The body of the Christian is no longer hers, and the life are no longer commodities to use as she pleases. But you have become, when you become a Christian, you now belong to God, and so therefore your life and your body now belongs to Him. And so you have to start asking that question, who do I belong to? If I belong to Him, then He owns me. All right? You were bought at a price, he says in verse 20. And the price is a very high one. Maybe you've heard the story before about the flea market, where there are people walking around the flea market. You know, you've been to those. They don't sell fleas. But they, well, sometimes they do, depending on what you might take home with you. Okay? But you go to the flea market, it's kind of like a huge garage sale, you know, where you got all these people selling stuff at a discount. A lot of it's used. And so somebody came along, and here was a violin that was for sale. Somebody probably had bought it when it was, you know, there for their child, and then they, you know, they said that, oh, if you just buy me a violin and give me lessons, I will learn it, you know, and you know how that is. And then, you know, 3 weeks later, they're bored with it, and it doesn't get played anymore. Unless you're Rebecca, you know, then you stay with it, you know. And so... And so this violin, it wasn't an expensive violin. It was just an old, you know, just a basic violin. But it had been sitting and collecting dust for years in the garage, and then finally they decide it's time to get rid of this violin. And they take it to the flea market and they put it out there. And everybody walks by and it doesn't look like much, and it's not a Stradivarius or anything like that. It's not an expensive violin, but you know, nobody's even making an offer on it. You know, somebody came by and said, "I'll give you $2," and you know, maybe how about $3? You know, and then they're not really, you know, taking it seriously as very valuable. But then while that's going on, a master violinist comes up and sees the violin. He goes, "Ah," and he says, "Would you mind if I tried it out?" And the owner said, "Sure, go ahead." And he takes the violin and he tightens up the strings and he gets it tuned up, and then he holds it out and then he begins to play some of the most amazing, beautiful sounds that anybody ever heard. And all the talking and all of the bartering and everything else that was going on at the flea market suddenly quieted as everybody stopped to listen to this master play this violin. And then when he got done, he set it down. And suddenly people started saying, I'll give you $100 for that. I'll give you, you know, no. And somebody else said, "No, I'll give you $500. Suddenly the violin, which had no really intrinsic value, suddenly it went up in value because of the touch of the master's hand. And so here's something that was really an example of what you and I are like. We may be like that violin. We're not valued very much. There's not much that we might see in ourselves. But God says, no, the value is what I pay for it. You know how much something is worth? What somebody will pay for it. That's how you determine worth. Okay? If nobody's going to pay you more than a dollar for something, then it's not worth much. But if you have something that somebody's willing to pay you thousands of dollars or tens of thousands of dollars, then you know that has high value. Well, God paid the ultimate price. He gave his son for you and for me. You were bought at a price, and it was a high price. Therefore, we belong to God and we belong to one another. Galatians chapter 2, verse 19 says, For through the law I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again, in 2 Corinthians 5. And then Romans 12, he says, Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. So, it's not my life anymore. I'm living for another, and I am to be living sacrificially. I am to be giving my life to God as a complete offering, as a form of worship. See, worship, true worship is not singing songs. True worship is living a life of sacrifice to God. True worship is saying, God, what do you want me to do with my life for you today? We heard it from Josephine in the word that she had. It's all about saying, God, here am I. Use me. Lord, here am I. And as we lay our hearts down, as we lay our lives down to God, that's how we are to live, because we have been purchased by God. We have been bought by a price. Number two, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. He tells us that. He says, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Now, what do you think of when you think of a temple? Well, when I think of a temple, I think of a couple things. I think of a place where worship of God, where he is honored and he is worshipped, he is exalted, he is lifted up. That is a temple, is where God is lifted up. Secondly, it's a place where God dwells. God is there. People often say, that's where God is. He's in that temple. He dwells or he lives, and he demonstrates his power in that temple. Well, I want you to know that God says that your body is that temple. And so now you and I are the place of dwelling and the place where God is honored and worshiped through us and in us. And so when we understand that, we understand that that our lives take on a different meaning, a different purpose. We are not in this world to get all we can get out of it. We are in this world to give back to God all that we can that He's made of us. He has created us as people that are His temple. And so He is to be worshipped in us, and people are to see and experience God through our individual lives. He says, all things are permissible. We often stop there. People say, all things are permissible. I can do anything I want as a Christian. Okay, yes you can. But then he says, but is it beneficial? Does it glorify God, or does it grieve the Holy Spirit? We have to stop and ask the right question. Many years ago, a young couple had their first child. He was a boy. And as the boy began to grow, they noticed that he had musical talent, so he could play, well, what we're on that on theme today, he could play the violin. And so he began to try, and he find they went out and found the best teacher that they could find to help him. And so they were told about a Swiss maestro who used to teach, and now he was retired. And they decided to try anyway, and they took their boy to him. And when the maestro heard the boy play, they recognized his ability, and he decided to teach him. And so the teacher, the boy was 8 years old, and for 10 years, his teacher worked with him almost every day. And then the time came for his debut. And his parents booked Carnegie Hall. And the press and all the important people came. And the lights dimmed, and the boy came out on the stage. And from the very first note, he held the crowd mesmerized until the very end. And when he finished, the people stood to their feet, and they filled the hall with cheers and with applause. And yet the boy ran off the stage crying. And the stage manager yelled, "Get back out there. They love you, and they're all cheering, and they're all clapping." And the boy replied, "There is one out there who is not." And so the manager ran out on the stage, and he came back quickly, and he says, "Okay, there's one old man out there who's not applauding. You can't worry about what that one old man thinks when the whole world loves you." And the boy replied, "But you don't understand. That old man is my teacher. And he's the only one whose opinion matters to me." You see, when we're walking with God and we're serving with God, it doesn't matter what everybody else says. It doesn't matter if you get the applause of the world, if you don't get the applause of the one. Because He's the one that we're serving. And so the question about our behavior is not, is everybody else okay with it, but is God okay with it? Is the life I'm living one that pleases Him? Can I ask His blessing? Can I take Jesus or involve Him in anything that I'm about to do and wherever I'm going? Just because something is allowed or approved by the world or legalized in the world doesn't mean that it's the right thing to do. Just because Bruce Springsteen thinks it's okay doesn't mean it's the right thing to do. When I was a youth pastor, and yes, I was at one time. Actually, I still am. I still consider youth people that I'm pastoring, no matter how old you are. But I remember one of the things when I was a brand new youth pastor, I started getting bombarded with these questions. "Pastor Dave, is it okay to do this and still be a Christian? Pastor Dave, is it okay to go to R-rated movies and still be a Christian? Pastor Dave, is it okay to go, you know, go to this worldly event? Is it okay to listen to acid rock music and still be a Christian? Pastor Dave, is it okay to go to school dances and still be a Christian?" Yeah, it was an issue back then. And still be a Christian. And I mean, and I'm like, how do I answer these questions? And I started to pray. I said, "Lord, how do I talk to these kids? What do I say? What's the response here, you know, without dealing with this issue of legalism versus grace and, you know, all of that?" And I was trying to answer the question. And as I prayed about it, God just dropped the whole answer right into my heart. And I went back, and at the next youth service, I said, "You kids are asking the wrong question. God told me that you're asking the wrong question." The question shouldn't be, how far away from God can I get and still remain under His grace? How far away from God can I get in my behavior and still be saved? You're asking the wrong question, because if you're asking that question, your heart's in the wrong place. Instead, you should be asking the question, how close can I get to God's? Not how far can I get from Him? And so that when we are understanding that we are a disciple of God, when we are a child of God, and that we live for Him, then we understand that some things are permissible, but they're not beneficial. They're not good for you. They're not right for you. They're not what God wants for you. And so stop asking how far away from God you can get and still stay saved. Instead, start asking God, how close can I get to you, God? Show me ways to draw near to you, Lord. That should be our passion and our question. He said all things are permissible, but does it control you? Whoa, now we're getting into some serious business. We are free from sin, so why go back and be a slave to it all over again? In Romans 6:15, what then, shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness? And so there's an issue sometimes we have to understand is we say, well, I'm free in Christ. I can do whatever I want and still be saved because I believe in Christ. Well, you have to start tweaking what that means to believe in Christ. But here's the thing. You can give yourself to something because you think you're okay, and then you can become enslaved by it. Charles Swindoll, former pastor in Southern California and also author of many books and former president of Dallas Theological Seminary, he writes this article about habits. He says, I used to bite my fingernails right down to the quick. I'd rip those babies off just as soon as the first signs of new growth would appear. For well over 20 years, I carried around 10 ugly stumps, which resulted in two miserable experiences. Number one, personal embarrassment. I was always afraid of such things as clean hands inspection at school and summer camps, and doctor's exams where the man would look down and groan at my mitts. And then number two was physical limitations. If I ever dropped a dime, forget it. The same for trying to pick up a toothpick or pluck out splinters or put in tiny screws. My mom tried all sorts of gimmicks to make me stop. Money bribes, red hot, burn your mouth stuff painted on my nails, wearing gloves day and night, public embarrassment and private reminders. But nothing worked. I mean nothing. I'd go right on and bite them off until they'd bleed. I remember having dates and keeping my hands in my pockets the whole time so the girl wouldn't notice. And I avoided card games. I skipped piano lessons. I refused to try on rings and stayed away from handcraft projects. How I hated that habit. I wanted so badly to stop that I would stay awake at night thinking about it. But the simple fact is, or was, that I couldn't. In spite of the pain and the pressure, that habit, like all habits, had me in its grip. As an American educator, Horace Mann once described the predicament, habit is a cable, we weave a thread of it every day, and at last we cannot break it. But God began to convict me about my nail-biting ways. It took him nearly a decade to bring about a final and complete victory, ashamed as I am to admit it. And during the process, he gently yet pointedly caused me to see that this was an area of my life much deeper than eight fingers and a couple of thumbs. I was being enslaved, mastered, and manipulated by the beast of habit. I was a living contradiction to the liberating truth of 1 Corinthians 6:12, that all things are lawful to me, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful, but there I will not be mastered by any of them. You can't believe the fire of conviction that this verse once set ablaze within me. The Greek word translated mastered means to be held under the authority of something. A close look reveals that it isn't a verse talking about something lawless or wicked, but something that is usually lawful, but just not profitable. My first encounter with the verse was not my final encounter with this painful habit, but it was certainly a turning point toward change, thank God. The backwash of this nail-biting testimony has far-reaching effects. Not a person who reads this book is completely free of bad habits. Whether wrestling with a habit of as accepted and common as overeating, or exaggerating, or cheating, or procrastinating. Others by habit are negative and suspicious, resulting in habitually closed-minded responses. And while some are ungrateful and demanding, others are continually extravagant and undiscerning. Some of you feel trapped by overt dependence on alcohol consumption, addiction to drugs, cravings for nicotine and caffeine, the lure of sensual lust, or a pill for every ill. Habits like gossip, worry, irritability, and profanity are often practiced without guilt, justified through cleverly devised mental schemes. The list is endless, for the habits are as numerous as every detail in life. Wow. Habits. Maybe a few or one of your own suddenly comes to mind. You see, that falls under this issue here, in that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, we have to understand that all things are permissible, but not everything is beneficial, and we should not be mastered by any of them. Is there a habit that's mastering your life today? Is there something that you do that is more important to you than God, or more important to you than your relationship with God, more important than your relationship with your family? Is there something that has control over you that you say, oh, that's no problem, I can stop any time, but yet, have you ever tried? Maybe you can't. The power of the indwelling Spirit is there to give us victory over sin and habits, and is all the power you need. His power can give you that power. And then number three, we are destined for resurrection. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. I love that statement. I don't get too attached to the pleasures of this world or the issues of this life because I know that they're only temporary. We've got to get our eyes focused on eternal things. There's a story about a man named Mirhan Karimi Nasiri. For 11 years, he was a man without a country. For 11 years, he lived in a Paris airport. He had no passport, he had no citizenship, he had no papers that enabled him to leave the airport or fly to another country. He had been expelled from his native country of Iran. And then he was sent away from Paris, France, because he lacked the documentation. He said his Belgian-issued refugee document had been stolen. So he flew to England, but he was denied entry and he was sent back to Paris, where he was returned to the Paris airport in 1988. Airport authorities allowed him to live in Terminal 1, and he stayed there for 11 years, writing a diary, living off of handouts from airport employees, and cleaning up in the airport bathroom. Then, in September of 1999, the situation reversed. French authorities presented Nasiri with an international travel card and a French residency permit. Suddenly, he was free to go anywhere he wanted. But when the airport officials handed him his walking papers, to everyone's surprise, he simply smiled, tucked the documents into his folder, and resumed writing in his diary. They found that he was afraid to leave the bench and the table that had been his home for 11 years. As the days passed and Nasiri refused to leave, airport officials said they would not throw him out of the airport, but they would have to gently and patiently coax him to find a new home. Can you imagine a more unnatural place to be than the airports? It is bustling, it is interesting, but it's not home. And when we come to Christ, we have to understand that God has created us for a new place. This world is not our home. The Paris airport is not your home. The PDX airport is not your home. Okay? As nice as it might be, all right? It is a place that this man stayed for 11 years, and once he got freedom, once he was set free, he didn't have the courage or the ability. He became so comfortable where he was that he didn't want to leave it and go out and enjoy real life. Many Christians are so comfortable in their old life that when Jesus sets them free, they're still not ready to leave it and go out and begin to live the life that God has called them to live. God has a plan and a purpose for you, but if you're too attached to this world, you'll not be able to live in it. I have been united with Jesus, therefore my head and my heart and my body are yearning for another world. Not this one. Some of us are a little too at home in this world. And if we were to be put into heaven, we might feel a little out of place. God has called us to something new. God has saved us because we are destined for resurrection and to be with Him. Our heavenly focus should be for a heaven-bound people. And we see in that verse, Colossians 3, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Is that where your eyes are today? Is that where your heart is today? See, God, if God has saved you, He has saved you from something, and He's also saved you to something. He saved you to a new life. He saved you to a new walk with Him and to a new relationship. And so the answer to the question, how should I live, must first be answered by the question, who do I belong to? And if I belong to Jesus, then my life is different. Either you belong to the devil, and therefore you live like the devil, or you belong to Christ, and you live for Him. There should be a change. People that say, well, I'm saved by grace. I prayed the prayer. I came down and I prayed the prayer and I filled out the decision card, so I'm a Christian, right? Well, maybe. If you genuinely did that, then yes. But you're brand new born into a new life, and guess what? Life is going to change for you. Things are going to be different because of who you belong to now. And He has called you to live a new life. And so I want to challenge you today. Where is your life? What is your behavior? You say, well, my behavior doesn't matter because I'm saved by grace, right? I'm united with Jesus, right? Well, let me tell you something. You're united with Jesus, but your behavior reflects who He is. And so God has called us to a life that's going to change our behavior. Does our behavior save us? No. But it is a response to the loving God that we have that says, I'm going to live the way He's called me to. Bow your heads with me, please, this morning. I want to close in prayer today, but I want to ask some questions before I do. Maybe you're here today and you'd say, Pastor Dave, you know what? I've got some habits. And I'm not real happy with them. There's some things that I didn't realize that they were controlling me, but now that you've talked about it, I really think that they're things that have got a grip on my life. Maybe it's not destroying you, but it's bothering you, you know, like biting your nails. Or maybe there's something more serious. Maybe you got a problem with profanity, or maybe you've got a problem with pornography, or maybe you've got a problem with using some kind of drugs or alcohol and it's controlling. Maybe you got a problem with nicotine. Maybe you're addicted to food. Say, what? Yeah. We can be gluttonous. Food is important, but maybe there's some things in your life that it's time to say, God, it's time to give You control of these areas of my life. I don't know what they might be. Doesn't matter. Nobody here has to know what they are, but you and God need to know. Maybe God's saying, it's time for you to just give that to me. It's time for you to surrender that to me. And I'll set you free. It might not happen in an instant. It might take some time. It might take asking God and working with God and allowing Him to change you over time. The Spirit can do that. And then I also know that I've seen people with habits break them in an instant. I've seen people that have been chain smokers for 20 years stop in a dime because of the power of God. So maybe you've got something in your life and you say, you know what? This is controlling me. this is something in my life that I don't want. This is a habit that needs to be released to the Lord. No matter what it is, small, medium, or large, if that's you, just lift a hand and say, Pastor, pray for me. I want this habit gone out of my life. Yes, thank you. Yes, that's, yes. A number of you, thank you. Yes. Amen. Thank you. Maybe you feel like that old violin at the flea market. You have no value. Maybe you feel like you're just tossed aside. You've been out gathering dust in the garage of life. You don't think you're worth anything. Why don't you know that God has placed a huge value on you? He said, you're worth the life of my son. And he wants to come into your life, and he wants to transform your life, and he wants to fill you with himself and with his spirit. He wants to give you joy, and he wants to give you victory, and he wants to give you heaven. He wants to give you all these things, but you've got to say yes to him. So if you're here today and you say, Pastor Dave, you know what, I think that's me you're talking about. I'm that old violin, and I need the master to come and play my life. I need the master to pick me up and tune me up and make me new. I need Jesus in my life. I've been running from him. I've been keeping him out of my life, and it's time to come home. It's time to let Jesus become the Lord of my life. If that's you, would you slip up a hand and say, pray for me too, Pastor, because I'm receiving Jesus today. I'm inviting him into my life today. Stand with me, please. My precious Lord and Savior, I thank you. I thank you, Lord God, for the power of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord God, that you loved us enough to die for us in our sinful condition. And yet, you don't want us to stay that way. You want to transform us, and you want to set us free from every bad habit and every issue that's holding us back in our walk with God. So Lord, I pray for those today, especially that raised a hand and said, I've got a habit that I want to give to the Lord today. I've got a habit that's time to be set free from. I got a habit that this thing controls me. It makes me feel guilty. It makes me feel bad. I want to be free from it. I don't want it anymore in my life. Lord, I pray for those people right now in Jesus' name that, Lord, your Holy Spirit will come alongside them and say, I got this. I got this. Just let me have it. And Lord, I pray that you will set them free. I pray that you will heal them. Heal them in their mind, heal them in their body, heal them in their spirit. And Lord God, let them walk free from these things that have been controlling in their lives. Oh Lord, it doesn't change our spiritual status with you. You love us just the same. You love us with and without our habits. But Lord God, you also want us to be free because you love us. And so Lord, I pray that Lord God, you will transform those lives. You will heal those lives so that they can walk in the victory. They can walk in the blessing. They can walk in the power of the Holy Spirit and say, God did this in my life. God changed me. God healed me. God set me free from this in my life. And what a testimony it will be to their friends and their family. Lord, thank you right now as you pour out your Spirit into every life to do that. As you heal lives, as you change lives, Lord God, as only you can, I pray. Lord, I give you thanks for that. I can't do it. All I can do is point people to you, Lord God, and I know that you have promised to do it. So, Lord God, in Jesus' name we receive it. In Jesus' name we accept it. We are set free today in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Got a song to sing? What do you think? All right? Let's sing something on the way out, okay? I think that it helps to solidify what we're doing. Amen? Amen. Pastor Brian's going to, I put him on the spot. He's going to have something ready for you in about 10 seconds. 9, 8, 7. Oh, thank you, brother.
She's an assistant university.
Oh. Thank you so much. All right. I will keep that. Thank you, sweetheart.
Say pray for me because I'm so bad in allergies.
Oh, I so feel sorry for you. My wife is the same way.
You are so overwhelmed. I hear the sound of your voice. All at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross, forgiven and free.